In the Buu saga of Dragon Ball Z, we were told that Potara Fusion is permanent, but that was quickly changed after Vegito is absorbed by Buu and the supposedly permanent merge is split up. This is later explained in Super to be due to a time limit for mortals who use the Potara, but that leaves a very interesting question on the table. What if Potara Fusion was truly permanent? What if Vegito never unfused? So our story starts inside of Majin Buu, where Vegito has been absorbed according to plan. Now that he's inside the pink monster, he can lower his barrier and find the others who were absorbed by Buu. When Vegito lowers his barrier, nothing happens. The merge is truly permanent, so of course, there are no issues here. Easily after entering Buu, Vegito is able to locate and rescue Gohan, Goten, Trunks, and Piccolo. The interesting part here is Fat Buu, who's inside Super Buu, and whether or not Vegito would remove Fat Buu or not. Considering that the Vegeta side of Vegito saw Fat Buu fight Skinny Buu, and the Goku saw some good within Fat Buu as well, I think it's likely that they would. Of course, this begins to revert Super Buu to Kid Buu. But even so, Vegito is easily able to defeat Buu before he can even fully transform. Now, Buu was never the interesting part about this what if, so there's no need to linger on it. Buu is defeated. Just know this means Earth isn't destroyed, though everyone on the planet besides the handful from our cast of characters are dead. Between Earth's Dragon Balls, which will be ready in a few months, and the Namekian Dragon Balls that Dende suggests using, everything is reverted to normal, and the general population of Earth is made to forget that Buu ever existed in the first place, as originally happened. Now that everything is returned to normal for the most part, there are some questions that need to be answered, especially from the two wives of Vegito. Which wife will the fusion choose? Which wife will be left alone for the rest of their days? Well, this answer may seem boring, but I don't think of Dragon Ball as a series with this type of drama. So for me, the answer is very simple. Vegito wouldn't go back to either. This is the most reasonable answer in my view and avoids the weird picking of a family, which just seems wrong to me. Notably, Vegito really isn't like Goku or Vegeta very much in my view. He's mixed, enough to be his own person, and thus isn't really appealing to Bulma or Chi-Chi either. Side note, I know a lot of people think he's more Vegeta-like due to his use of Kakarot in his fused name, but Vegito was actually originally supposed to be named Gogeta. As far as I'm aware, this was changed to avoid confusion with the Fusion Reborn movie, so there you go. The more you know. So with Vegito isolated, he can focus on his training. Bulma takes care of Chi-Chi financially, so Vegito can spend his time the way he wants, especially after being given the money from Mr. Satan. While he's still a father to all three of his children, Vegito has become a figure that's more like a master of martial arts than anything else, seeming hermit-like, just as Grandpa Gohan and Master Roshi were, even adapting to some of their father-like qualities when raising his own children. Notably, with Goku and Vegeta not coming to the conclusion of the Spirit Bomb at the end of the Buu saga, this means his Goku qualities still have him thinking that the next generation needs to be prepared to take over for him once he's gone. A single protector of Earth must be found. Goten and Trunks are easy to convince to keep training, but Gohan feels like he's not needed. He wants to focus on his scholarly pursuits and Videl, but Vegito is part Vegeta, so he doesn't let him. He presents Gohan a possibility, a time where Vegito isn't around or isn't enough. A time where Gohan's family is in danger, but due to him getting soft, he can't protect them. Arrogance and complacency are Gohan's biggest weaknesses. If he wants a life as a scholar and eventually a father, he'd have to stay strong enough to protect those goals. The message gets through to Gohan, and he agrees to keep up on his training in his off time, allowing him to grow to new heights, though the gap between him and Vegito was never truly closed. Since, of course, Vegito's base form is arguably stronger than Ultimate Gohan in the manga, and definitely stronger than Ultimate Gohan in the anime, I think it's clear that base to base, Vegito is far stronger than Gohan. Vegito may also be Goku and Vegeta's potentials multiplied together as well, since it's just multiplying the two in their entirety together. Regardless, know that for the time being, Vegito is beyond Gohan and will remain the strongest character in the series for now. So with Buu dealt with and Vegito's future sorted for now, 4 years pass until the God of Destruction awakens, coming to Earth in search of the Super Saiyan God, the first rival to truly challenge the God. Since the Saiyans have been training for the past 4 years, they are more than prepared for the arrival of the God of Destruction, though their battles with Beerus are purely for entertainment, as the God of Destruction hasn't had the displeasure of meeting Majin Buu yet. Despite their training and each of the Saiyans being one of the greatest fights Beerus has ever had, none are enough to satisfy him, not even Vegito. The fights do make the proposition of meeting a Super Saiyan God all the more enticing for Beerus, though, and with Vegito being partially made up of Goku, he obviously thinks of using the Dragon Balls to find the Super Saiyan God, just as Goku did originally. But they're instead given the ritual, as also happened originally. This, of course, leads to the ritual being performed and failing, since they are two Saiyans short. Videl steps forward and announces she's pregnant, but Whis points out they'd still be a Saiyan short. Now, we could go one of two ways here. One, the ritual doesn't work, or two, the combination of Vegeta and Goku's ki will work for the sake of the ritual. Let's go with the latter just to be a bit simpler with things. So Vegito explains to Whis that he is the merging of two Saiyans, and that might suffice for the requirements of the ritual. To everyone's astonishment, it does work, and the Super Saiyan God, Vegito, is born. Beerus smiles. He can feel the God Ki radiating off of Vegito and can tell that this will be different. Better than anything that has come before it. In terms of raw power, Vegito here should be pretty insane. After a year of training with Piccolo and on his own for a bit, Gohan goes from barely being able to turn Super Saiyan to rivaling Super Saiyan Blue Goku right before the Tournament of Power. Just to be clear here, this is directly stated by the narrator and then later shown to be true again when Gohan fights a powered up Dispo while keeping up with Golden Frieza, the same Golden Frieza who was relative to Super Saiyan Blue Goku before the Tournament of Power. Like it or not, that's how strong Gohan got in just 1 year of training. The point of showing all this is to make us realize how ridiculous a Gohan after 4 years of training with Vegito and Vegito himself would be, as we've already covered that he probably has potential on par or relative to Gohan's, so this would mean something pretty crazy for Vegito as well. In 4 years of training, it should be fair to say that Ultimate Gohan and Vegito have gotten at least that strong. Remember, Whis himself says that Saiyans fighting each other is relative, if not better, than his own training, so that supports this even further. Let's downplay even further and say that Vegito needs to turn Super Saiyan to reach that level, not just base form. With even all of that, Super Saiyan God is a ridiculous multiplier. If you thought Kaioken times 20 Super Saiyan Blue Goku in the beginning of the Tournament of Power was impressive, this blows that away, and we're only at the beginning of Dragon Ball Super. Needless to say any further, Super Saiyan God Vegito is a beast and satisfies Beerus, eventually leading to him training with Whis, eventually mastering his God Ki and unlocking Super Saiyan Blue. From here, things are just easy, to be completely honest. Well, at least for a little while. Even if Vegito is off-world when Frieza is revived, what will a revived Frieza do when a Gohan who hasn't stopped training comes to face him? A Gohan whose ultimate form can close the God gap after just a year of training. A Gohan who has 5 more years of training since the Buu Saga and has surpassed early Tournament of Power Super Saiyan Blue Goku. Obviously, this is just an easy win for Gohan, and Frieza doesn't get the chance to destroy the planet, as Gohan's arrogance has already been addressed by Vegito. That moves us to the Universe 6 tournament, of course. What will the Universe 6 tournament have to offer when Vegito easily beats Hit, probably without even resorting to Super Saiyan Blue, and definitely not needing Super Saiyan Blue Kaioken, which he should be able to do. So Vegito just solos the tournament with no difficulty. Then of course Zeno would make his appearance, and while less goofy than Goku, Vegito is still a bit naive and makes Zeno's acquaintance, even getting another tournament promised as happened originally. With the tournament won by Vegito single-handedly and the Super Dragon Balls free for Beerus to use, Vegito asks if he could have the wish. Beerus considers it and says why not. Vegito was the one to win them after all. Vegito asks to be split up once again. He would like to return to being Goku and Vegeta. If these Super Dragon Balls could truly grant any wish, then maybe, just maybe, their merger could end here. Beerus looks a little saddened by their wish request, but shrugs and agrees. Vegito assumes he's sad to be losing his rival, but that wasn't it. Whis gives Beerus a look, but Beerus tells Whis to try it already. No harm in giving it a shot. So Whis recites the wish to the Super Dragon Balls, and Super Shenron responds that Potara merger is truly permanent. There is no undoing it. Goku and Vegeta were in essence destroyed when Vegito was created. There's no Goku and Vegeta to return to, even if the permanence of this merger wasn't a universal law. Beerus had expected this to be the outcome, but decided to give it a shot anyway. He apologizes to the merged Saiyan, seeming sincere for the first time ever. Vegito tells him not to worry about it. This was his last chance to split up again, so he's already resigned to the idea that he will forever be Vegito. Beerus then wishes for Universe 6's Earth to be restored as he did originally, and they return to Beerus's planet. However, all is not right in the universe. Actually, it's not right in the timelines of this universe. Soon, a rogue god will seek to steal the body of Vegito in retaliation for his transgressions against the gods, which is, it's basically just him existing. That's all he did. Now, I'd love to give a winding tale about the struggle to beat a Vegito Black, but this is how I really see events playing out. Trunks arrives in the past and sees Vegito. He tries to strike out at him, fearing him to be the evil Saiyan found in his timeline, but that fear is quickly put to rest. Vegito explains who he is, and Trunks is now even more confused by the future version of the merged Saiyan. How could a Vegito and Goku fusion be in the future where they died decades ago? Even if it were them, why would they be evil? Vegito tells him not to worry about it. Whoever Vegito Black is, he shouldn't be too hard to beat. A bit of time passes after this conversation, and a rift opens in the sky, a portal to the future timeline, and from it comes Vegito Black. Vegito doesn't hesitate and confronts the false version of himself. He asks who he is, but Vegito Black says that's a question that doesn't need to be answered. Vegito tells him that's a shame, since they won't get a second chance. Notably, Vegito is pretty decisive in his battles. He enters with a goal in mind and does whatever he can to achieve that goal. Whether it be to be absorbed by Buu or to destroy Merge Zamas, though he was prevented from doing the second one due to the time limit shortening outside of his control, he is far more decisive than Goku and Vegeta when it comes to his fights. Because of this tendency to try and achieve his goals immediately without trying to have fun with the fight, Vegito Black, who still can't even use Super Saiyan Rosé, is a nothing fight for Vegito in Super Saiyan Blue, who quickly manhandles and kills Vegito Black. Only a moment later, Vegito Black's corpse is returned to the future timeline. This doesn't fix everything though, so Vegito asks Trunks if they can go to the future timeline together. There might be a way for them to fix this mess if they go. So Trunks agrees and the two travel to the future. Once there, Vegito teleports Trunks to New Namek. Since it's in the same general location as the present timeline, he's able to find it no problem. Once there, they are able to collect the upgraded Namekian Dragon Balls and use them to return Earth to the way it was before Vegito Black showed up. Vegito thanks the Namekians and takes Trunks back to Earth, where he is reunited with his mother and Mai. Trunks thanks Vegito for everything, but before peace can truly return, a notable key is present on Earth. Zamas, immortal and alone, is furious to see his work undone. Vegito quickly teleports to him and stops the rogue god before he can cause any destruction to the newly restored planet. It doesn't take long for Vegito to realize Zamas is immortal, but he can still be knocked out, which is exactly what Vegito does. Once Zamas is unconscious, Trunks takes Vegito to the past once again, and Vegito hands Zamas over to Beerus. He tells Beerus that this is the person responsible and that he's immortal. Beerus recognizes Zamas and says Vegito Black had the same key, so that makes sense. Whis gives Beerus a version of the Z-Sword, and using the blade, he seals the immortal god forever. Since, as Beerus says in the manga, and Whis implies in the anime, Beerus can't kill immortals. I don't know why people think this. He literally says he can't in the manga, and the anime is really clear about him not being able to as well. Obviously, Trunks returns to his timeline, but only after spending a day in the present waiting for the time machine to be refueled. Using this time, Vegito takes Trunks to Elder Kai and has his potential unlocked. This should help keep him strong enough for any future threats, so long as he continues to train, of course. So Trunks leaves the present for good this time, stronger and more prepared than ever before. From here, the Tournament of Power happens a year later. Now, I haven't spoken about Whis's training for Ultra Instinct yet, and that's because it would make Vegito even more OP than he's already been. What I mean by that is Vegito is the combination of Vegeta and Goku, of course, and because of that, their opposite traits that stop them from achieving Ultra Instinct immediately are compensated for by the other person. This makes Vegito the perfect fighter by Whis's standards, and for me, this would be enough to allow him to achieve at least Ultra Instinct Omen at Will from Whis's training alone. Now, imagine a Vegito who's far stronger than either Goku or Vegeta at the beginning of the tournament, and has access to at least Ultra Instinct Omen. And that's being generous. I think he probably could have mastered it because of his lack of family time required. I think there's clearly a running theme here, and it's very simply that Vegito just sort of solos due to his high potential and his high power difference at the very beginning of the series. As for the Broly movie, I actually don't think it'll happen at all. Frieza, if revived, won't be a big factor in winning the tournament, and if Beerus doesn't revive Frieza, the Earth Dragon Balls literally can't because he was already revived once. In the anime, this is framed as a knowing lie by Goku, while the manga makes it Goku just forgot what the wish limits were. Regardless, if the Broly movie did happen, then I think it's still clear that Vegito solos pretty easily. It's genuinely a non-contest, and he may not even let it get as far as it did originally. Seeing the good in Broly and how misguided Paragus is wouldn't lead to him killing either of them. With that, I think this is where the story should end. Being overpowered is cool and all, but makes for a fairly boring narrative, all things considered. I hope you enjoyed the story regardless. Make sure you like and subscribe if you did, and thank you so very much for watching.